Hello friends, and welcome to Smart Coach. Today we are going to deal with a very important section from our APSC Assam history, okay? And that would be the Varman Dynasty, okay? Its importance can hardly be understated. You see, the Varman Dynasty is the first historical dynasty of the entire Northeast, okay? It is the first historical dynasty, by which we mean that sources of history, all right? Sources are available in abundance, and therefore we can make certain, informed ideas about the Varman Dynasty. Before this, we had to depend upon mythology and texts such as the Puranas, all right? Now remember, although the Puranas are not considered to be historical documents, but then of course history can be extrapolated from the Puranas, all right? However, the problem here is that the Puranas are very mythological in nature, and therefore the history that can be extrapolated or extracted from the Puranas cannot be considered to be accurate. However, for the Varman Dynasty, for the very first time, we get historical sources. These sources are of many kinds. These can be numismatic, epigraphic, all right? And this can also be in the form of written manuscripts, all right? For the Varman Dynasty, we have certain important sources. And let me write down the sources before we begin upon the political history of the Varman Dynasty. Most important sources for the Varman Dynasty are in fact epigraphical, all right? Among this are the Dubi Granths, the Nidhanpur Granth, the Badaganga Granth, all right. These are epigraphs made after land grants, all right. This is the earliest such epigraph. It was made by Bhuti Varman, all right, who was the 8th ruler of this dynasty. And then these grants were made by the most important ruler of this dynasty, Bhaskar Varman. We also get mention of, the Northeast from the Allahabad pillar inscription or it is also known as Prasasti, S-H-A-S-T-I, Prasasti. It is an eulogic inscription about Samudragupta, the great Gupta ruler. Samudragupta, it was composed by the court poet Harisena. It is inscribed upon a Ashokan pillar, which is now situated in Allahabad Fort, in Allahabad, okay? Here also in the Allahabad pillar Prasasti, we get mention about various dynasties of the Northeast and various Northeastern kingdoms, such as the Davaka kingdom, the Pragjyotisha kingdom, okay? And here also, we can make certain conjectures from what we read in this pillar Prasasti. Apart from this, we have got a manuscript also in the form of Harsha Charit, all right, by Banabhatta, all right. This can be said to be very important because it is from here that we get accurate information about the Varman Dynasty, but that too about the last Varman rulers, okay? Not about the very early Varman rulers, okay? Apart from this, we also get the C.U. Key, all right, which is a travelogue kept by the Chinese traveler Yun Sang, who is known to have traveled to the Northeast, to the Varman kingdom, all right, and he kept this travelogue, and in this travelogue also we get to know various things about the rule of Bhaskar Varman and also about the society, the land of the Northeast at this point of time, the extent of the empire, the climate, etc., etc., okay. These sources together combined give us a very good idea about this very early kingdom of Kamarupa. Okay, so now let us move forward with the political history of this first historical dynasty of Kamarupa. All right, so moving forward, the very first ruler of the Varman dynasty who established this dynasty is known as Pushya Varman. All right. By analysis of epigraphic dates, especially the dates given by the Badaganga inscription, historians have concluded that he must have lived in, or he must have established this dynasty somewhere in the 350s or the middle of the 4th century, all right, 4th century common era, okay. Now, these are of course conjectures. Some also say that he was a contemporary of Samudragupta. But we will go forward and look at the controversy surrounding all of these things, okay. However, what we know for certain from other inscriptions is that Pushya Varman traced the lineage of his dynasty to that of Naraka, who was a mythological ruler of Assam, okay. Now, the dynasty is, its lineage is traced back to Naraka, all right, that much we know. And this immediately confirms that this dynasty was either an Aryan dynasty or these people were Aryanized, all right, through a process of Sanskritization, okay. However, we cannot be very certain about this conjecture, all right. The title Varman, all right, as well as the use of mythologies of Aryan culture, okay. This says that this dynasty was either Aryan or Aryanized, but we cannot be very certain. Now, as far as the connection of the Varman dynasty with the Gupta dynasty or the imperial Guptas is concerned, what we know for certain is that the Allahabad Prelar Prasasti, it says that the Kamarupa, Davaka, etc., which are in the northeast, okay, they were feudatories of the Gupta dynasties. But the problem is Pushya Varman adopted the title of Maharaja Adhiraja, which is a title taken over, you see, contemporarily by or rulers who are independent. So, if this person is adopting the title of Maharaja Adhiraja, how can we, you see, be very certain about his connections with the Gupta dynasty? Or can we very certainly say that this dynasty, the Varman dynasty, at its very earliest stage was a feudatory of the Gupta dynasty? We cannot actually. But then, of course, another thing that can be pointed out about Pushya Varman is that he named his son Samudra Varman. And the wife of Samudra Varman was named Datta Devi, all right. Now, the parallels are very uncanny because Samudragupta and his wife Datta Devi, their names are mirrored by the son of Pushya Varman and his son's wife, and therefore, we get into this contradictory position when this person is claiming to be a Maharaja Adhiraja, at the same time he is naming his son after the name of a very great ruler of India, and therefore, what we can conjecture is that there might have been some kind of diplomatic relationship between the Gupta dynasty as well as the Varman dynasty, but we cannot be very certain if the Gupta dynasty was, you see, a feudatory of, sorry, not the Gupta dynasty, but the Varman dynasty was a feudatory of the Gupta dynasty. That we cannot be very certain about. Allahabad Prelar Prasasti also does not make any mention of the ruler or the name of the ruler. It only says that these kingdoms were feudatories or are feudatories of the Gupta dynasty, okay. So, we cannot be very certain about that. His son Samudra Varman also took on the name of Maharaja or name or title. Samudra Varman also took the title of Maharaja Adhiraja, all right, and this again suggests the independence of the Varman dynasty, all right. However, what we can be certain about is that by the time of Bala Varman, the Varman dynasty had also forged links with important dynasties across India, because during the reign of Bala Varman, it is written in Kalhana's Raj Tarangini, Now, Rajtarangini is an important source about the history of Kashmir. It can also be, Kalhanas Rajtarangini is sometimes also considered to be the first Indian historical document because it confirms with, or it is parallel, it runs parallel with the historical traditions of the West, okay. Now, in Kalhanas Rajtarangini, it is said that the rulers of Pragjyotisha had relations with the ruler of Kashmir. Specifically, the daughter of Balavarman, Amrita Prabha was married to the ruler of Kashmir, Megha Vahana. She is also said to have laid the foundation or a Buddhist monk who followed her in her journey, he is known to have laid the foundation of a Buddhist monastery in Kashmir. Now, this shows that the Varman dynasty by the time of Balavarman was also forging links with dynasties across India, all right. Next comes in this succession, next comes Kalyanavarman. Now, as far as Kalyanavarman is concerned, an important occurrence during his reign is that Davaka, which is identified with the Kapili Valley in Assam, also came under the reign of the Varman. However, it is also stated that Kalyanavarman sent a mission to China also. Not very certain, of course, but then of course we know or we can make a conjecture that Kalyanavarman, from extant sources of course, that Kalyanavarman sent a diplomatic mission to China, all right. Now, after Kalyanavarman, we get Mahendra Varman. Now, Mahendra Varman is known to have confirmed with Vedic rituals such as the Ashwamedha Yajna. He is known to have performed 2 Ashwamedha Yajnas during his lifetime, and some have even conjectured that during Mahendra Varman's rule, it is for the first time that Bengal came under the sway of the Varmans. Again, not many sources, and we cannot talk about it with certainty. However, it is conjectured that after the capture of certain areas in Bengal, Mahendra Varman performed Ashwamedha Yajna to solidify or to consolidate his rule over this or his victory over this new territories. Okay, but what we know for certain is that Bhuti Varman, who succeeded Mahendra Varman, took control over Pondra Vardhana in Bengal. Okay, this is the first recorded instance of the Varman dynasty moving outside of Assam and taking control over territories in Bengal. Okay, it is recorded and therefore it is undisputed. Again, the record comes from land grants, all right, which Bhuti Varman made in Bengal. Okay, in the Badaganga inscription, he is known to have granted lands in this region to 200 families of Brahmins. He is also known to have, made Ashwamedha or performed the Ashwamedha sacrifice. Thus again, confirming to the Vedic rituals associated with kingship. Okay, so by the time of Bhuti Varman, we know that the Varman dynasty is surely on the rise. All right, it is surely on the rise of to greater things. Okay, and Bhuti Varman is again known to have succeeded by Sthita Varman, Susthita Varman, and Supratisthita Varman, all right. Now, these rulers are important because it is during these rulers that we know certain kind of connections also come to light regarding the Varman dynasty and its relationship with the Gupta dynasty. We will look into it next. Now moving into the successors of Bhuti Varman, we find that during the reign of Sushthita Varman, the relationship of the Varman dynasty and the imperial Guptas again came into conflict, and during this time we know for certain that Mahasena Gupta of the imperial Guptas defeated Sushthita Varman, and this also led to the loss of territories in Bengal. Alright. However, these territories will again be regained back. Alright. We know for certain that these territories will be regained back by the greatest ruler of the Varman dynasty. We'll talk about him later. However, after the death of Sushthita Varman, Pratisthita Varman ascended to the throne, and his reign was short. All right, his reign was short. He died, and his brother Bhaskara Varman succeeded to the throne. Now, this Bhaskara Varman is the greatest ruler of the Varman dynasty, and he also forged links with other great Indian dynasties of his times. During his time, we know that the Buddhist traveler Yuen Sang also visited the northeastern region, especially Assam. All right, and for his rule, we also have various sources such as the Harsa Saritra, which talks about this kingdom. Okay, we know quite a lot about the Varman dynasty, the last ruler of the Varman dynasty, and therefore it would only be convenient if we take up Bhaskara Varman and his reign and the dynasty as a whole, his socio-cultural aspect, etc., in the next part of this video. Alright. For this part, we deal up till the rise of Bhaskara Varman. Also, remember in the political history that we just briefly ran with, we have eliminated or ignored certain rulers such as Chandramukha Varman, and this is because very little is known about these rulers, all right, and also nothing of very great importance took place during the reign of this ruler. Only that we can say that the empire was consolidated during this period, okay, and therefore we have not gone into detail about such rulers as Chandramukha Varman. But what we know for certain is that in our next video we will have to move into Bhaskara Varman. We have to deal with the socio-cultural issues and aspects and the political aspects of this very important dynasty of our Assam. All right, and therefore with that I take your leave. I hope this video helps you in your studies. We will meet again when we discuss the Varman dynasty part 2.